Assalamu alaikum dear students, this is lecture of Gross Anatomy, the lower limb. The topic of today is the anatomy of the posterior leg. For first professional MBBS students, I am Dr. Kalimullah, demonstrator, anatomy department, GKMC Sawabi. The posterior aspect of the leg is also called the calf. It is subdivided by a broad intermuscular septum into the superficial and the deep group of muscles. The superficial group include the gastrocnemius muscle or gastrocnemius muscle and the soleus muscle, the plantaris muscle. The deep group contains the popliteus, flexor hallucis longus, flexor digitorum longus, tibialis posterior muscle, and the nerve supply is from the tibial nerve. The blood supply is from the posterior tibial artery. The soleus and gastrocnemius muscle make a common tendon and insert upon the calcaneal bone. The calcaneal reflex is the test for the assessment of the S1 and S2 roots. Bursa between the skin and the tendon and between the bone and the tendon are called the retrocalcaneal bursa and the subcutaneous calcaneal bursa. These bursae, they avoid friction of the tendon against the skin and avoid friction of the tendon against the bone. The gastrocnemius muscle arises by two heads from lateral and medial respective femoral condyles. The insertion is upon the posterior aspect of the calcaneus. Its action is knee and plantar flexion. It is used in running and jumping. The soleus muscle arises from the upper fibula, the head of the fibula, and the soleal line on the tibia. It inserts in the gastrocnemius tendon and action is like that of the gastrocnemius muscle. The plantaris muscle arises from the lower lateral supracondylar line of the femur bone, inserts upon the posterior surface of the calcaneus, and its action is plantar flexion and knee flexion. The deep group contains popliteus, flexor hallucis longus, flexor digitorum longus, and the tibialis posterior muscles. The popliteus is a short muscle on the back of the deep group muscles. The rest of the three are known by the acronym the Tom, Dick, and Harry. Tom means tibialis posterior, Dick the digitorum longus, and the Harry the hallucis longus muscle. The tendons of all these muscles, as have been shown, and the medial aspect pass below the medial malleolus underneath the flexor tenaculum in the tarsal tunnel and enters the foot, the plantar aspect of the foot. The popliteus muscle arises from the lateral condyle of the femur and the popliteal ligament. It inserts upon the upper posterior surface of the tibia above the soleal line. On the right sided diagram, you can see the muscle origin and insertion, and you can also see the popliteal artery and tibial nerve are passing above the substance of the muscle. The function is flexion of the leg at the knee and produces unlocking. That is, the internal rotation of the leg at the knee produces the unlocking of the knee joint. The flexor hallucis longus arises from the lower two-thirds of the fibula, as has been shown in the diagram, and the intraosseous membrane and the intermuscular septa. Insertion is upon the base of the distal phalanx of the big toe and the shoulder aspect. The action is the plantar flexion of the foot and the flexion of the distal phalanx of the big toe. flexor digitorum longus arises from medial posterior aspect of the tibia, and insertion is upon the plantar aspect of the distal phalanges of the lateral four toes. The action is flexion of the lateral four toes and the plantar flexion of the foot at the ankle joint. The tibialis posterior, it arises from the upper parts of the tibia and fibula and the adjacent interosseous membrane. It has a broad insertion. It inserts upon the tuberosity of the navicular bone, the sustentaculum tali of the talus bone, and all the three cuneiforms and the cuboid bone and the base of the 2, 3 and 4th metatarsal bones. Its action is plantar flexion and inversion of the foot, and it also maintains the medial longitudinal arch of the foot. Okay students, now I am going to discuss with you the clinical correlates of the leg, the interior and the posterior leg. The anterior tibial compartment syndrome is a condition in which there is ischemic necrosis of the anterior compartment muscles. The cause is excessive exertion, and which results in swelling of the muscles and compression upon the arteries. The symptoms are extreme tenderness. Tenderness means to produce or to elicit pain upon touching an area, and the pain is on the anterolateral aspect. The treatment is to incise the fasciotomy and in order to decompress the area and release the pressure upon the arteries and the veins. Another painful condition of the anterior leg is the shin splint or the medial tibial stress syndrome, in which there are stress fractures. There used to be pain, and the pain is along the shin bone or the tibia bone. The causes are excessive pressure or impact on the lower leg muscles and walking or running upon the uneven surface or running downhill. The symptoms of the shin splints are mild in severity and tenderness. The feet may feel numb and weak. The pathology is swollen muscles. The differentiation between the shin splint and the compartment syndrome, we can take an X-ray, and in the X-ray we can find the stress fractures in the tibia. The muscle cramp or Charley horse. This is sudden involuntary painful contraction of muscles of the lower limb. It is a North American expression of 1880s. The cause is prolonged sitting causing fatigue of the muscles, overexertion, dehydration, depletion of the electrolytes like calcium, sodium, potassium and magnesium. There is poor blood supply as well. Now, how to understand the deficiency of substances? Muscle spasm during exercise, likely due to potassium deficiency or the vitamin E deficiency. The toes cramp at night pointing upward can be due to calcium deficiency. The toes cramp at night and curl down can be due to magnesium deficiency. Waking up suddenly with a cough or thigh cramp can be due to calcium or magnesium deficiency. Muscles affected are calf muscles, hamstring, quadriceps muscles. The cramps can subside spontaneously within minutes and or can be treated by gentle massage or painkillers. The management is calm provision of rest and calcium lactate. Vitamin E is very effective for cramps during exercise. Charley horse is actually the body's way of telling you the existence of the deficiency. Intermittent claudication or limping. The etiology is ischemia of the lower limb muscles, especially the calf muscles. It occurs in occlusio-peripheral arterial disease. The symptoms are pain in the limbs on walking, intensifies until walking is impossible and relieved by taking rest. Another condition is the rupture of Achilles tendon or the calcaneal tendon. It is a common running injury and usually occurs in middle age with a history of tendinitis. Its presentation is there is sudden cough pain with an audible snap, a click-like sound, inability to plantar flex the foot, palpable gape in the complete rupture area. A clinical condition of the posterior aspect of the leg, the restless leg syndrome. It is a neurological sensory motor disorder. A sense of restless or unpleasant discomfort inside the leg during sitting or lying. It is accompanied by an irritable urge to move the legs. The movement, like walking, brings temporary relief, but it is worse at rest, evening and night. The cause is unknown or idiopathic. It runs in families and affects 10% adults and 2% children. The ankle jerk or the Achilles reflex. This is a reflex twitch produced by the tapping of the triceps sore tendon, the tendon calcaneus. Triceps sore are the gastrocnemius, soleus and plantaris combined name, and it causes the tapping of this particular tendon causes plantar flexion. This is test for the L5 to S2 segments. Both afferent and efferent reflexes are carried in the tibial nerve. Now the foot drop. The cause is the paralysis of CPN or the common peroneal nerve as shown in the diagram on the right side. The mechanism is unopposed pull of the plantar flexors which produces permanent plantar flexion. The disability is affected limb drag along the ground during walking. The patient flick the foot outwards while walking, known as an eversion flick. Okay students, with this we have finished the discussion of the anatomy of the leg. I hope you would have followed me. Thank you very much. God bless you.